Hey folks, if you want to get deeper into our discussion with Matt Cameron, make sure to download our bonus episode featuring Matt's responses to your questions. It's available now at our website, thetrapset.net, iTunes, or your favorite podcast app.
The Trap Set will always be available for free, but we rely on donations from our listeners. Please visit our website at thetrapset.net and click donate. Subscribe to our show on iTunes, and if you enjoy what you hear, give us a review.
This is Joe Wong. Welcome to The Trap Set, where each week we explore the lives of drummers. I want to play something for you. You're hearing Mailman by Soundgarden, featuring my guest, Matt Cameron on drums. Cameron joined the influential Seattle band in 1986 and brought with him a singular playing style that combines brute force and exceptional finesse. His meticulously composed parts, delivered with unwavering confidence, helped launch the band to critical and commercial heights. Soundgarden ended its initial run in 1997, and Matt was soon recruited by Pearl Jam. He's the band's longest tenured drummer and has contributed to 6 studio albums and countless tours. Matt's musical activity extends beyond the drum kit. He's consistently written songs for both Soundgarden and Pearl Jam. He sings for his own band, Wellwater Conspiracy. He's collaborated with everyone from Geddy Lee to Zach Hill and Janet Weiss. And he's currently preparing for tour with the reunited supergroup, Temple of the Dog. Now our conversation with one of the all-time greats, Matt Cameron.
I must say that my father was a really avid jazz fan, and my parents grew up in, you know, the 30s, 40s era swing, swing time, when groups like, you know, the Benny Goodman, Dorsey, Artie Shaw, Duke Ellington, Count Basie, like those guys were on the road all the time, and so they would always play San Diego. So my parents always had really good memories in the jazz age. My father took me to see Buddy Rich when I was about 13. And that made a pretty enormous impact on me.
Did you meet him?
Did not meet him, but he played at our community college in Chula Vista, where I grew up. So my dad did expose me at a pretty young age to jazz.
Did they nurture it more as a hobby, or were they open to you pursuing it as a career?
I think it was just they were sharing their love of this style of music with me, you know? But once... Once my dad realized I could play drums at an age, I guess I could, you know,
How old were you when you started?
I guess I started taking lessons at around age 10. I got a practice pad around age 9. I had requested, you know, to get more into drums. I was just strictly a, you know, outside kid on my bike and, you know, just being outdoors. So, I requested a practice pad and so I got lessons around age 10. Didn't really stick. Like, you know, it was just more like traditional stick kind of, you know, troll. I guess I wasn't completely clued into the benefits of taking lessons. I wanted to take that next step into into being able to play the music. So I figured I would just, I just kind of naturally gravitated towards, you know, riding motocross and surfing for a few more years. And then I got back into it when I was around age 14. Some neighborhood kids and I started a Kiss cover band. So I was gigging around.
And the name of the band was?
The name of the band was Kiss. Thank you very much.
Spelled the same.
Spelled the same. We didn't think there'd be any legal issues there.
But there were, weren't there?
Until we received a letter from Acoin Management stating that we had basically had to cease and desist using the name Kiss, which at the time we were crushed. We thought they were going to give us a letter of approval. You know,
how were they even aware of you?
Well, my father was best friends with the stagehand union head in San Diego, so we were able to go to a Kiss sound check, and we gave Kiss our photo album of us as our Kiss cover band, like playing, you know.
Did you do the makeup and everything?
Yeah, we did the makeup. Our moms made the costumes and everything. So that, you know, that took over my life for probably a good like 10 months, you know, at age 14. I was fully into that world. So I basically started playing in cover bands around, you know, 14, 15. So it wasn't only that one band, but there were other neighborhood bands, high school bands, things like that. I played in the high school jazz kind of jazz choir ensemble, you know, like the jazz singers. I'd play in that ensemble, things like that.
Were you listening to a lot of jazz by the time you were in high school?
You know what? By the time I reached about age 17, so probably like, you know, my senior year, I really started to listen to like a lot of Coltrane and Miles Davis, and that really resonated.
Elvin and Tony in particular?
Yeah, absolutely. Elvin and Tony were just two huge influences on me. You know, but like I said, my father took me to see some jazz when I was around 14, and he took me to see Count Basie, actually, and I saw a drummer by the name of Butch Miles playing with Count Basie at the time, and I did get to talk to him a little bit. So that was, you know, that was nice to actually get to meet someone that had just come off the stage and completely blew my mind, you know. So I remember how nice he was to me, and I wanted to make sure, like, just, you know, back of my mind, if I could ever be in his position, I would certainly want to be nice like that.
Did you have ambitions to be in his position by that age?
You know what? I think after seeing early rock concerts at age like 15, 16, Bowie was my first big rock concert. Like, I think I emailed you when we were going back and forth about Dennis Davis passing away. After seeing, you know, Queen and Bowie and Aerosmith and Cheap Trick and Kiss and kind of all the 70s touring groups at that time, I was definitely turned on to just the whole idea of it. I didn't have any clear ambitions about putting myself up there. I just knew that I had a real visceral reaction to rock music and being a drummer at that time, like sort of developing and being able to pull off, you know, some drum things that I hadn't been able to pull off the year before. So I [S2] Yes. [S1] Felt like I was getting better at, you know, like my mid-teens. And then by the time I hit around age 17, I started to take lessons real seriously with a gentleman named John Santo, who played with the San Diego Symphony and the Harry Parch Ensemble.
Were you a Harry Parch fan at that
age?
Well,
not until I had met my friend John, because he exposed me to a lot more esoteric style of classical music and jazz. And, I mean, Harry Parch wrote a really cool opera and everything, so... So yeah, after, you know, taking lessons with John, I felt myself developing even further, and most of it was just rudiments, you know, hitting the pad, reading, learning dynamics, just kind of learning to approach drumming as a full musician, you know, as opposed to just coming in there and bashing it out, you know.
How did you decide to come to Seattle?
I was playing in a group called Faultline with a friend of mine named Glenn Slater in San Diego in like 1980-81, and we would play parties and, you know, keggers, just stuff like that. We stayed in touch. He moved to Seattle in 1982, and his parents live up here. So he just said, hey, you should come up and bring your drums. You know, I'm playing with some guys up here. Come up for a visit. So I packed up my drums. I think it was February 1983.
So you were about 21 at the time?
I was 20.
Were you in college?
No, I was not. I went to 1 year community college after high school and just kicked around. I played in a bunch of bands, cover bands, and workday jobs and things like that. So this just felt like it would be something different to try. You know, it was wasn't thought out at all.
Do you reflect back on that when you're making decisions now, that sometimes you can overthink really crucial decisions? And
yeah.
Sometimes if you just make a decision on the whim or with your gut instinct, that's the best option.
Sure. And I did it at the right time as well. You know, so.
Good thinking.
I know, right? But isn't that a part of being able to make those types of decisions, like the time of your life where you're at? You know, for me, fortunately, it was young, raring to go, full throttle. Let's do this, you know. But I knew coming up here that I was going to have at least one opportunity to play in Glenn's band. So. You know, I lived in his parents' house for, I don't know, 4 months or something, slept on people's couches. Then we all got day jobs and rented a place in North Seattle.
What was your day job?
I worked at a pizza parlor. And then...
delivery? Making the pizzas?
I was back in the kitchen.
Nice.
Prepping.
Do you know how to throw dough?
I do. I know how to throw dough.
So you'll never be hungry.
I can always go back to that career. And then I worked at a Kinko's Copies for like 2 or 3 years when I first started playing in bands up here. And they were actually really, really good about me going out on tour and being able to come back and have a job and stuff. Like when I first started touring with Soundgarden. So
were all of the Soundgarden flyers made at your
absolutely.
Kinko's?
Yeah. Tad, a lot of the Sub Pop guys would come mill the night. We would take care of them. We'd give them like 500 free posters and stuff like that.
Yes.
Hell yeah.
We would drop the counter that you would put in the copy machine so it would reset. Oops.
There's all kinds of tricks. I was more day-to-day at that time frame, you know. It was basically about, you know, I guess, you know, looking back, I was really poor. And I just, you know, I just wanted to know where I was going to sleep that night. So, yeah, when we did get a house, it was a godsend. But you know, I think I was still developing as a musician. I started to meet a lot of the guys that, I would eventually be playing music with in the very near future. I started gigging around, you know, like 83, 84, as soon as I moved here. So there's plenty of opportunities and some really cool little venues to play at that time. And then from there, after that, you know, I got some day jobs and just kind of tooled around and I guess got my reputation around town and started playing with Daniel House from Skin Yard. We always kind of played music. We did 4-track cassette recording together. And you know, I guess I must say that was a pretty big moment in my life, getting a 4-track cassette recorder in like 1985. I got a Fostex 250.
I had a Tascam 424.
Oh, dude, that thing, I think I developed so much as a musician just having that, you know, as far as like, you know, well, I've always been interested in songwriting and playing guitar and things like that, but just being able to put music together in such a nice, tight little unit like that was a godsend at that time.
Did you start writing lots of your own songs at that point?
I did. I certainly did. And around 1985, as soon as I got that thing, I just was going crazy. And I met a lot of, home recording enthusiasts at that time. And we would just, throw our cassettes back and forth, or we'd all go to someone's apartment and make music together. And, I just felt I was doing that like all the time with people. And this is before I started playing in bands or anything, so I was able to witness the kind of more esoteric side of the Seattle kind of art scene, in the early '80s, early to mid '80s. And so that was really nice.
The bands that you're most famous for playing in were kind of branded as, they were kind of associated with the notion of angst and anger and disenfranchisement.
Right.
Were you a pretty happy kid? I mean, it sounds like you came from a really nice, supportive family, and those things didn't necessarily apply to your situation.
Totally. Yeah. I met all the angst-ridden people when I moved to Seattle.
Did you feel like you fit in with them? Like,
absolutely.
You did.
Yeah, absolutely. Kim often teases me about being the most, well-balanced member of Soundgarden, because I didn't really have a traumatic childhood. But, I guess I always just really gravitated towards the misfits, though. Like, one thing I really liked about the people in Seattle that I met was they were really, creative. There's so many creative people up here, and they were kind of doing their own thing. Like, it was fully, obsessively focusing in on, your sort of version of what you're trying to get across as an artist, and it wasn't just strictly music, and it was pretty tight. It was small, just kind of grimy, tight community of a really good art scene. So I felt like as a kid I didn't really have too much of that growing up in San Diego. It was so kind of laid back, and people just wanted to get a full-time job at Costco and go live on the beach somewhere and surf. And
was that ever a possibility for you?
No, I mean, I think I always was looking for a situation to broaden my musical horizons. I came to Seattle completely on a whim, and I had no real plan other than just moving to a different city and trying something different.
You mentioned that at age 17, you started to take lessons really seriously.
Yeah.
Were you, or are you, by nature, a pretty disciplined guy?
I would say half and half. I know there's parts of my year where I am very disciplined, and then there's parts of my year where I do like to be pretty lazy and, be with my family and with my dogs and my friends and everything.
Even the fact that you partition it into parts of your year makes me think that you're actually a pretty disciplined guy.
Well,
now is
I think
the time
I've
be lazy.
I think I've always been disciplined, yes. But it's never been through a desire to, make money, or that's never been
But to be great at drums.
I've always wanted to be good. I've always wanted to be good at what I do, So I think that has always... I think I've been able to figure out what it takes for me personally to be able to do what I do at my level, and I'm called upon to do, stuff that's not that technically hard, but it's just there's a performance aspect to it now that I really take seriously. Whereas before I was just I'll just go on tour, da da da, whatever. But now I'm just I really gotta prepare to go on tour.
What do you mean by that?
Training, just gym time, basically. A lot more awareness of where my body's at before I head out, and practicing too. Where my body's at, just sort of physically and musically, where my body's at.
during your downtime, you let your playing atrophy slightly and then you get back into shape?
Yeah, for sure. Like, you know, I think if you don't keep it up, then, I mean, if I go for more than like a month without playing, then yeah, if I come back to it, I'm definitely tight and sore and everything. So drumming is the type of thing that you have to keep doing or else it's pretty easy to lose.
The other thing that you just mentioned was that, you know, you have to take it more seriously when you go out on the road, even if the music isn't necessarily that complicated.
Mm-hmm.
What about the kind of like emotional commitment aspect? Are you able to do that every night? Do you feel like you can get really inside the music?
I certainly try. I mean, as a performer, that is the goal, is to be able to lose yourself in the music. And in my case, it's like, it's a lot of this music that I'm performing now, it's like I sort of had a hand in it, like, you know, in its creation a long time ago. So
do you feel like you've always had a pretty strong faith in yourself or in the universe that things would more or less work out?
I don't know about the universe, but I think I've always had a pretty hard kind of core, like, yeah, there's something, yeah. Like,
where do you think that comes from?
You know, for me, I remember as a kid, like, getting swept out in rip currents in the ocean. And I just remember, like, it happened a lot to me. And after a while, just being able to get out of that situation and calming myself. And I don't know. I think that was a big, I just remember that as being like a crystal clear moment of like, okay, you can do this. But I don't know. I think it was, but yeah, just probably the way I grew up, you know.
You have kids, right?
I do have kids, yeah.
Do you try to put them in a similar set of circumstances to what you had?
Throw them in the middle of the ocean.
Well, I mean, like metaphorically speaking, like how do you instill that sense of self-belief in them?
Yeah, I certainly try to instill confidence in them, and it's all about supporting their interests and... you know, just making sure that that they can always come to me, that, you know, that there's always a voice that they can trust in their lives. But as far as like kind of getting to the inner you know, that inner spot in a person, for me, it just, I don't know, I think it was just maybe something I was born with. I didn't really grow up with too much organized religion, but, you know, I think it does have something to do with, the, you know, the spiritual side of the world, possibly, just, you know, having a belief in yourself, you know.
I didn't grow up with any organized religion, so I kind of had to navigate my own.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thing. Well, my parents were really great too, but I had to think about a lot of things sooner than most people. I had early existential crises.
Sure. Sure.
Did you?
Absolutely. You know, I think it hit me around, you know, late teens, early 20s, for sure. Like, what am I doing with my life? And, oh, I'm terrible. It's like, you know, sometimes you just wake up and it's like, oh, God, this is not working today, you know?
Do you still feel that way sometimes?
You know what? I mean, sometimes, maybe on the road, sometimes there's days where I know I've got a really big day ahead of me and I just got to, like, you know, I just can't worry about it and just get out there and do my best. But I think I used to get it more like, yeah, around like late teens, early 20s, just, you know, I was reading too much Kafka. I don't know what was going on, but I loved it at the same time. I loved sort of like getting close to that sort of dark edge of you know, where our life can go, you know? And I guess that's what we tapped into here in Seattle. I mean, it's known
for a gloomy place.
It's doom and gloom for sure.
Seize the day.
episode of The Trap Set is brought to you in part by Colectivo Coffee, handmade coffee since 1993. Check them out online at colectivo.com.
How did you meet the Soundgarden guys?
Well, I was a neighbor of Kim's. We used to live in the same neighborhood in Fremont, and he was a fan of Skin Yard. And I was a big fan of Soundgarden around that time, 85 or so, 84, 85. But before that, I had played a gig with a band I was with called Feedback. We played a pizza place called Morningtown in 1984, I believe. And there was a band we played with called The Shemps, and that was Kim, Hero, Chris, Scott Sundquist, and then a friend of theirs named Matt Dentino. So that was the first time I ever saw Chris perform, and he was about 18 or so.
And he was singing or playing drums?
He was singing. Okay. And they were playing Doors covers, and I just remember Doors covers for some reason. They might have had some originals. I thought the band was like, you know, they're kind of okay, just kind of garage band, but I was blown away by seeing a 17-year-old Chris Cornell. So that's when I first like met those guys. Kim and I were neighbors, and I would see him out at gigs more so than the other guys. Chris used to work at a vintage clothing store, and so I'd see him around town occasionally, just around downtown and stuff. I'd seen him play probably 3 or 4 times, and I always thought they were I thought they were the best like Seattle rock band at that time. No one could touch them, in my opinion. So when the opportunity came to you know, audition after Scott left, I was all for it. It's like, Kim, let me do it. Get me in.
Do you feel like you had instant chemistry when you played with those guys?
I think so. I mean, yeah, because we'd known each other, and we kind of knew what each other was about musically, and we all liked the same bands, and yeah. So I think it was a really, really good fit from the get-go. And they were kind of weirdos too. Like, I mean, I really remember like Kim and Hero, especially, like, they liked, you know, Albert Eiler, and they liked all kinds of jazz and Captain Beefheart, and, you know, it's kind of not just rock music. So it was, yeah. So I was definitely the right guy for those guys, for that band.
What do you see your role as creatively in the band?
In Soundgarden?
Yeah.
I think it's a pretty big creative role. When I first joined, it was strictly, you know, drummer. And then after about 2 records, I kind of figured out the formula a little bit. And it was really fun for me to be able to contribute music to the band, you know. And after the guys responded positively to it, I really dug my heels in and tried to contribute as much as possible. And so I guess, you know, I think that they like the fact that I can bring in stuff every record, you know, and I think it's different from what the rest of the guys tend to come up with. So it's a different approach to, you know, riff rock is basically what we do.
When do you feel like that band really started moving forward?
Around 91, about 90, 91. As soon as Ben came on board, I felt like we were all
peaking. Did you lose anything when Hero left the band? Did it feel like a setback at first?
Yeah, to me it did. As a drummer, I felt he and I had a really strong telepathic kind of playing style that was our own thing. So I was kind of curious of how I was going to get that with someone else. But we were really busy at that time. We had so many tours booked, so many gigs, and that we just had to, we had to keep it going, you know. We couldn't sit around and mope about it. And he was clearly not happy at the time, so it was kind of, you know, you don't want someone there that doesn't want to be there.
So the year's 1991. There's a lot of attention being focused on Seattle.
Yes.
You guys put out Bad Motor Finger that year. Ben joined the band.
Right.
All of these stars have aligned, and now you're a rock star. Did it feel
rock
like
star?
You're...
Rock star? Not the term I would use, but continue.
Okay, what's the term that you would use?
I was working.
A successful working musician.
I was a working musician, yeah. Yeah.
Why wouldn't you say that you were a rock star?
To me, rock star is the singer, you know, guitar, something like that. So, you know, like Rod Stewart, David Bowie, Mick Jagger. I mean, I think that's...
Chris Cornell.
Eddie Vedder. I mean, I want those guys to be the rock stars, you know.
Right.
I'm happily behind them, supporting their their glow in the spotlight.
Okay, so you're a successful working musician with some notoriety.
Thank you.
How did your life change?
I was gone all the time. I was on tour all the time. So I think my life as a touring musician got a little better. We were able to get our own rooms. I remember that was a big deal for us. We got a bus. So the traveling got a little bit better. It became a little bit of a whirlwind in the sense that we had to keep producing and, you know, keeping, you got to keep the ball rolling because all of a sudden you've got a lot of people that are making money off this thing, whereas it used to be...
It's a machine.
It becomes a machine, right, once it becomes successful. So those inherent pressures were felt by all of us, I think.
Is that something you take to heart? Like, oh, people's jobs are depending on us making something good.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Or not even necessarily good, but popular.
Well, I don't think of it in the creative
realm,
but I think of it in the performing realm, for sure. Like, that's definitely a part of it where you have to keep that side of it going as well, because that's where kind of the, you know, the livelihood factor comes in for all of us. I mean, that's kind of how we make our money these days. But at that time... there was sort of this whirlwind element attached to it all, of like, you know, just our music scene becoming really, really big and powerful, and you know, all the bands from here started to have commercial success, and so that gave us a little more clout, I guess, in the industry. But
were you any happier because of it?
You know, I was happy that the music was getting better.
Did money make you any happier?
No, not really. But I loved being able to buy, like...
A sweet car,
yeah. I mean, I loved that feeling of... I came home from a tour and I had enough to go buy a new BMW M3. And I was just like, yes! Yes! I always hated paying rent. Okay, so I was able to buy a house.
Yes.
And I think, you know, if there was a goal, that was it. Like, to be able to not fucking pay rent. So that felt great. Like, that kind of stuff felt fantastic. And the fact that I could, you know, pay my mom off. I borrowed some money from her when I was a kid. And things like that was just, that felt fantastic.
Everything was rolling along, and then the band broke up for a while. What happened?
Well, 97.
97.
Is when the band officially split. Well, we came to a point where it just wasn't fun, and there was personal tension, and it just wasn't like a positive kind of vibe out on the road, you know? And Chris was really... I think he was ready to start a solo thing and just kind of get that whole thing started.
Have you had to go back and address the issues that were causing that tension now that you've been playing together again?
You know, we did talk about some stuff, like when we first got back together to talk about some business issues, which eventually led to us playing music again together.
How did that happen? Like, you were meeting up together to talk about publishing or something, and then yeah, you're like, you know what? Let's go make some more money.
pretty much. Yeah, it wasn't, you know, we were, that's basically it. We got back together to talk about, I don't know, like some merchandising or something like that, you know, just getting t-shirts out there or something. And yeah, so it just kind of, we just started talking about some other issues, and we decided to try to, you know, give it another go.
Well, when the band did break up, were you devastated? Or did it feel like just kind of
yeah,
the right
thing? I was, yeah. I mean, it took over so much of my life at that point it was pretty crushing. I wasn't completely shocked by it, but anything that you put that much effort into and that much of your life into, you know, when it's gone like that, then it's definitely a transition for sure.
What was your next step?
Next step? I had about a good 8 to 10 months off. I just kind of jammed with my buddy John McBain. Josh Homme was in town, so we kind of got his whole Queens of the Stone Age thing started around that time, 98, I guess, with Mike Johnson. We played one gig at the OK Hotel. McBain and I did some Wellwater Conspiracy.
And that's the band that you sing in?
Yes, yes. It's kind of psych. Garage psych music.
Did you feel more vulnerable as an artist once you started singing versus playing drums?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's a whole different mindset, and it's something I'm definitely not comfortable doing. But
does
it's
that
also
make it more fun?
It's really fun. Yeah, it's really fun.
Do you feel like you need that in addition to facilitating other people's songs?
I do. Yeah, I do. I've always really enjoyed writing music, and I think it just helps. It helps me as a musician to be able to have that side always remain intact. And I sometimes get most excited about being a musician when I am writing music and I am coming up with songs. Sometimes that's I guess I don't do that as much as I would like to these days. I hope to do more of that in the near future. But, you know, luckily for me, I've got a killer performing gig going on. So, you know, that takes precedent right now.
Well, let's talk about that other gig that you have.
Okay.
You had about 10 months off.
About, yeah, almost a year. Yeah.
And you hear from who? From the Pearl Jam camp.
Yeah. And I also got married. That's one thing I did during my time off.
How did you arrive at the decision to get married?
Well, I had just an awesome girlfriend for years and years and years, and
you're like, now that I'm not in a band anymore, like, I might as well get married.
Now that I don't have a paycheck, it seems like the perfect time, honey.
What does she do?
She is a classical musician. She went to Peabody Conservatory, and she's also
Baltimore.
Yeah, yeah, Baltimore. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So she's the legit musician of the family.
What does she play?
She plays viola, and then she's also a jewelry maker, and a mom. You know. But at the time, I don't know, it just felt like it was the right time to do it. And I, you know, we wanted to raise a family and everything like that. So we did that. And then I was actually calling up Stone to inquire about him putting a Wellwater Conspiracy record out on his label Loose Grooves at the time. So I called him up, and he said, "Hey, what are you doing this summer?" And I'm like, well, nothing. I'm not doing anything. Hey, we're leaving in 4 weeks, 3 weeks. You know, we got a tour booked. Jack quit. So I got the lowdown on that, and that's how it all started, you know, innocently enough.
Were you excited?
I was excited. I was a little worried about the workload that I had to, learn all the music, like, inside and out for a tour.
How does that dynamic function differently than Soundgarden, and how did you change as an artist by playing with those guys?
Well, it's just different band dynamics, just kind of in general. Like, you know how band dynamics are. They're multifaceted. They're everything you could ever imagine in a family. But I think there's a lot of similarities, like, just in the sense of, like, how we all kind of play music together. And I think maybe my role in Soundgarden is a little more of a musical director role, whereas with Pearl Jam, it's more of a supportive, you know, in the rhythm section type of role. So I think the collaboration I have in Soundgarden is a little bit bigger, like in the creative realm. But they're both, like, I feel really fortunate to be in two such really fantastic bands, you know. Jeez
Louise.
I'm lucky.
Are you lucky?
Yeah, totally.
You didn't earn it?
I totally earned it. I worked my tail off for it. But I mean, I think there's always an element of luck in success in the music industry.
Yeah.
For sure.
Right.
For sure.
You don't have any control over whether or not the music is going to become popular. You can only do what you do.
Absolutely. But having said that, I think it's really important to try to stay clued into what, you know, what's current and what's sort of, like, you know, how can I fit into what's going on right now and into this, you know, this scene or this, you know, this town I just moved to, or this, you know, whatever it may be.
What do you do to stay current?
Do
you listen to music with your kids?
I do. My son is he's a big, like, classic rock guy, so we love listening to music together, but it's mostly older classic rock stuff. My daughter's, she's into, you know, One Direction and Demi Lovato, things like that.
Do you think that we're fucked as a species? Like, you know, lots of the lyrics.
Joe, you're going off topic here.
No. I'm coming back around. Because I think having kids is an act of good faith. It's an act of good faith because you're saying, all right, the human race and the planet isn't irredeemable. We haven't gone so far off the rails that it's hopeless.
Yeah.
So, you know, and part of the reason I started doing this show is because my girlfriend at the time wanted to have kids. So the first guy that I got was Brendan Canty, who you probably
great
know.
Great dad.
And he has, like, four kids.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, how do you do this, Brendan? Tell me. I don't know if I really got the answers, but... Yeah. okay, so I feel like once you have kids, you have a greater stake in the future of the planet. So, so how do you feel about the way that things are going right now?
Oof. I'm a little worried, actually. You know, I do worry about future resilience of our planet, basically, right now. Just being able to sustain all these annoying humans that are that are everywhere. But you know, we do tell our kids that they're going to be inheriting a pretty nasty situation with, you know, with our planet. And we try to also instill in them that you know, they do have the power to change it with, you know, with their generation. So, yeah, it's, I mean, you sort of have to think in those terms when, you know, when you do become a parent. But that's a quandary. That's a quandary right there, for sure.
Are you guys vegan or something?
My daughter's trying to be vegan right now, and it's a little bit annoying.
I was vegan when I was in high school. Ugh. In Milwaukee, which was really hard.
I bet.
And then when I moved to LA a few years ago, which is the easiest place in the world to be vegan, I started eating meat again. So.
Oh wow, that's.
I think I'm just a contrarian.
Yeah, you are.
Not a vegetarian.
Yeah, yeah.
Is there anything that you are pursuing right now that you haven't tried before?
Personally, I'm trying to just be more aware of you know, my health and like listen to my body more.
You look good, man.
Well, thank you. But you know, it's just more like kind of awareness of what's going on, you know, that might make you physically feel tired or ill. You know, and a lot of that stuff is just mental stuff as well. Like, just, you know, trying to be more compassionate with the world and with yourself, basically.
Are you more compassionate with yourself?
I think I am. I'm certainly trying to be more so in my older days.
It's going to make your drumming decrease, man. You got to be harder on yourself.
Dude, there's no angst left. Where's the angst?
By this, I mean, just watch videos of Tony Williams or Buddy Rich at your age and just ask yourself if you measure up. Okay, man?
I know, right? So true.
I'm just kidding. You're not supposed to do that. Matt Cameron, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you, Joe. My pleasure.
Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com. Make sure to check out Matt's answers to listeners' questions, now available on our website and iTunes.